Does that sound clear enough? Yeah? Okay. Thank you so much for coming today, and thanks to the amazing musicians and also the amazing Hannah and Ian for reading before me. So I'm going to read for a little less than 20 minutes, I guess. So the first poem was inspired by something I read in a newspaper back in 2000. So I was reading the film section, and there was a lot of speculation about the casting for the very first of the Harry Potter series of films. And you know, the books were already bestsellers, so everyone was wondering who would be cast as Harry and Dumbledore and all of these characters for the very first film. So this article was just kind of Hollywood gossip about who was being cast, and in the middle of the article it said, "The only confirmed cast member is Oop the Owl, who has been tapped to play the snowy white owl who delivers mail for Harry." So I was really interested in the idea of this owl who was going to be an actor in these movies. And I didn't actually know the Harry Potter books, so I didn't realize there were owls involved at all. So the poem is in the voice of this owl, who in real life is named Oop, and the character in the movies, I think, is named Hedwig. So the title of the poem is actually, "The only confirmed cast member is Oop the Owl, who has been tapped to play the snowy white owl who delivers mail for Harry." Claw up, claw down, cut. My fine eyes are cut. I was fluffed and plucked like a beauty pageant winner, between takes, like a news presenter. Could I be a news presenter? Rider, 5 rashers bacon, 8-ounce tin mixed nuts, 2 pounds rabbit fillets, assorted droops. Between takes, I did leg lifts in my trailer. If asked what is your most treasured possession, I would say, the woolly toy Tracy, my personal trainer, gave me when young. I learned to spy it from afar, then swoop down and seize, but only on cue. Mr. Sheep goes everywhere with me now. If I could wake up having gained one ability, it would be the capacity for more facial expression. It is so tedious to have one's beak set in a permanent frown. My greatest talent is impersonation, to simulate a person's idea of an owl. Sadly, I owe my success to typecasting. My greatest fear is to be found wanting. At the premiere party, the women were not very clothed. It is of advantage to be clad always in feathers. I allowed fake friends to pet me. My picture was taken several times with the boy. I enjoy parties because otherwise I see only Tracy. Afterwards, you wonder what the glitter was for. I also just wanted to thank Poets and Players, obviously, for inviting us here today. And, I was going to mention, if you buy any of my books, the profits will go to Poets and Players, so you're kind of helping to support them if you buy them. So the next poem is about ninjas, which, I guess, just in case if you don't know much about them, they're like these figures from Japanese history or folklore. You know, they're like, they wear all black and they're kind of assassins. They run around in secret. They're in pop culture a lot nowadays. And this is just like my idea of what ninjas are like. It's not based on actual history or like Japanese lore or anything. And I guess near the middle of the poem, I use this American phrase, cater waiters, which is just what we call like the staff at fancy parties who walk around with the trays of drinks and canapes. On ninjas. They eat 4 cheese pizzas with 3 of the cheeses removed. They make friendship bracelets out of aluminium foil and poison. They open windows just by thinking about opening windows. They take ballet lessons to improve the speed of their circular arm movements. The ninjas are coming to save us from muggers and disorganized thieves and slobs who want to kill us. The way to spot a ninja is to look for someone wearing black pajamas, preternaturally neat black pajamas, with a hood for cover. The way to tell one ninja from another is by the ankles. The way to tell one ninja from another is, you can't. They know how to levitate by thinking about bird's feet. They make terrible cater wiggers because no one can hear them coming. Their mission is to save us from chaos with their acute tumbling skills and their climbing proficiency. They don't want to dismember bad jazz musicians or art teachers or con men, but they will. They know how to escape from a trap by running in place very, very fast. They can change places with each other by thinking about numbers. They turn themselves into fog to get out of attending boring parties. They make single-serving Lancashire hot pots to show their culinary mastery. They take turns doing the laundry. It's easy, no whites or colors. The ninjas are here to help us. They are as ruthless as history or defenestration. They are pitiless as a swarm of bees or evolution. They know how to throw fireballs and do their own taxes. They hate litter and small children. They are here to fix us. The next poem is kind of the only really cheerful or optimistic poem I've ever written. So hopefully it'll be a little bit of a relief from some of the other poems. I guess I should say near the beginning of the poem I used the word edema, which is a medical term that I learned from watching TV dramas like ER. And it means an abnormal swelling of a tissue or organ. And then near the end of the poem, I use this French expression, bonne journée, which means have a nice day. And the poem is just called This Morning. This morning, the romance of the world washed over me. My heart swelled with positive feelings, not edema. The forklift out the window beeped, I love you, in Morse code. A curious pigeon molested my bird feeding contraption. I pined longingly for my absent biscuits, which had been eaten last week. Even the unfriendly cat sensed the fragility of the moment and refrained from licking its bits. How sweet it was to breathe the sausage-scented air and feel the throb of the washing machine like a second heart, keeping me true. In the garden, a host of petunias dangled and waved their skinny legs. Oh, darlings, some days are painted with high saturation pigment. Some are faint as a blueprint seen from space. Today, the bees are droning a hosanna to wish me bonne journée. It's ridiculous to be so full of honey for a living. It's ridiculous how ardently the washing machine sings. Dear pigeon, I used to be a heretic from the world. Then romance washed over me. I think I might believe. So the next poem is from my book, The Ninjas. And when I was writing the book, I guess I found myself writing some kind of science fiction-y themed poems, which I'd never really done before. So I guess this one is about robots, and it was inspired by all of these movies and TV shows that have existed since like the 1950s, about where people are imagining this future time when there will be robots everywhere serving us and maybe taking over in the end. So in the poem, I guess I mentioned these two American brand names, one of which is Amway. It's a kind of direct sales company where people, like sort of like Tupperware, where people sell their products to other people in their houses, but it's kind of controversial or a bit dodgy. And then I also mentioned Red Lobster, which is the name of a chain of seafood restaurants in America. The robots. They meet in secret in electrified rooms. They are under surveillance by themselves. They sneak food out of our kitchens, even though they can't eat it. The password for their meetings is, "Please admit me, I am a robot," in robot language. They like to interface with ceramic-coated transistors for recreation. They keep robo-dwarf hamsters as pets. They have a financial interest in the Arena Football League, Amway, and Red Lobster. Howsoever you find them, they will appear ready to serve. If a robot crosses your path, it means your grandmother just died. In robot language, I and you are the same word. How many robots does it take to build a suspension bridge over the Grand Canyon? If you see a robot with its hands folded, it's planning something. They use our grammar to mock us. Cicero once wrote, "Robati non possunt fundi." It is not possible to defeat the robots. If they smile at you, it means you just died. The city of robots will be concentric, well-polished, and paradisiacal for the robots. In the city of robots, they will celebrate the holidays Bolting and Zinkfest. Their love of rabbits will come to the fore. The rest of us will be snuffed out like vermin. Happy will the robots be when they can practice kung fu in the open. I guess the next poem is a new one that's not in either of my existing books, although I wrote it a few years ago now, and I guess it's kind of weird because now it seems sort of topical or political or something, but at the time that I was writing it, I was just kind of thinking about my own parents and sort of the history of, you know, different kind of major groups that immigrated to America in the last couple of centuries. So it's kind of like a mishmash of those different groups. I use the word serape in the poem, which is the name of a kind of Mexican blanket that's often worn as a shawl or a poncho. If you think of like spaghetti westerns or things, you've probably seen a serape, whether you know it or not. Okay, I guess that's all you need to know. The poem's called A Short History of Migration. We boarded a seashell to ride across the waves. The mythology of our passage involved dirt, sharks, a zeppelin, and wires. We ate the same meal 17 days in a row, pancakes. We learned to say yes, please, in four different languages. Our fur-lined hats were useless in the fine September air. The mystery of our parentage was a serape on our backs. Out on the prairie, the locals tried to take us at face value. We learned about sturgeon, washing machines, ennui, and fake tan. We joined a Fruit of the Month club to widen our horizons. The mastery of our foliage required an endless sea of mowing. We attended bake sales with a suspicious degree of fervor. We hindered our children with violins, bad haircuts, and diplomas. Our names were changed to make them easier to remember. The monastery of our heritage was repurposed into handy snacks. We sold refrigerators to people who already had refrigerators. We lived in suburban glory in our new built townhouses. Our children were changed to make them meaner and fatter. The memory of our verbiage was as a schnitzel in the wind. We kept our money close and our feelings closer. In the event of an emergency, we kept a baseball bat prepared. I'm just going to read two more poems to wrap up. This one is called Double Wedding, 1615. So it's set in the 17th century, and it was inspired by the actual arranged marriage of these two royal couples. It doesn't really matter who they are for the poem, I guess, but it was Anne of Austria, who was betrothed to the future King Louis XIII of France, and then his sister, who was called Isabella of Bourbon, was betrothed to Anne of Austria's brother, the King of Spain. So it was like this weird crisscross kind of arranged marriage to create an alliance between the countries of France and Spain at the time. And the poem is in the voice, I guess, of the two women, kind of imagining from their point of view. Double Wedding, 1615. We are laced taut as an archer's bow strung with catgut, a lean and deadly spring to the touch. At each breath, our stomachs press whalebone, seven bent fingers, stiff as our own ribs and wrapped in linen, leaving the fine print of their weave on our skin. We are wired for great things and small movements, hooped to glide like gigantic orchids, full-blown, slow-footed, and deliberate in error. Afterwards, we will bear the strange marks of another house, gold arms on a gold collar, but for now, no other jewels hang about our necks than these. Pearls knotted with string, clasped with velvet, and fitted just the length to choke us. This day will slip from us, shedding marquisette, point d'esprit, zibouille, trailing taffeta and brochet behind it. It will leave us bare-handed and desperate to remember what we were before it. And it will take everything we have to recollect what we wore when we walked the length of the nave without stopping, how we kept our eyes straight and unturning until it was over. And the last poem is was inspired by, again, something I read in the newspaper in 2010, which was about the National Zoo in Washington, D.C., which, like a lot of zoos, had these two giant pandas on loan from China, and then they had a baby panda. And then when the baby panda turned four, it had to be shipped back to China to a panda conservation center, because that's like the deal you make with the Chinese government, apparently. So this baby panda, you know, had been born in the National Zoo and been like a huge favorite of all visitors, and its birth and life pretty much were all on the internet for people to watch, so even if they never went to the zoo, they would still be able to experience this baby panda's life. So there are lots of articles when sort of saying farewell to it when it was being shipped back to China. And in fact, just this week, another baby panda from the National Zoo was sent back to China as well. Anyway, this poem is in the voice of the panda, and it's just called An American Panda Leaves the National Zoo. I don't want to go. Give me another ice lolly the size of a tire with pear chunks in it. I'm too important to be sent away from my custom-built grotto, my waterfall, and my floofy bedding. There's a sweet potato waiting behind a rock for my long claws to pierce it. Another I hid in a bush for later. I don't want to go play with 150 strange pandas in China. Why can't I stay here and fondle a leafy stalk? All I want is to flop and loaf on my belly for hours like a furry hippo. People of Washington, this is the last time I'll comically fall off a branch for you, or get my tongue stuck while licking a fruity tire, or adorably flail my ungainly, pancake-like paws as I lie on my back, unable to get up. Will they have webcams in China? I don't want to live like a wild panda with no one watching. I love you, rocky outcrop where I clambered as a baby. love my electronic feeding chute and the llamas next door. A cranky bunch, but they always look like they're smiling. I don't want to give them up. When spring comes to this time zone, the cherry trees will start to snow, shedding their petals in a maelstrom of forgetting. Who knows what makes them do it? I'll love them till I die. This is the last place where people will speak to me in English, or play popular music to see if I'll dance, or make kissy faces at me from behind a glass wall. Adios, keepers. Adios, observers. Adios, playful otters. Adios, haters. There are always a few. I don't want to know about the future. It always gets here sooner or later. Thanks very much.